Hey everyone! So today I thought I would share some of the basics of Ayurveda so that you can understand your body a little bit better. So Ayur means life and Veda means knowledge. It is the oldest, most ancient health science to exist, and it's often referred to as the mother of all healing.
So living an Ayurvedic lifestyle is not just about food. It's actually a conscious way of living in order to empower your mind with the knowledge required to really understand how to optimize your mind, body, and soul. Ayurveda teaches us how we can tune into our bodies to really be able to optimize the internal and external environment in order to have the best health possible. So there are quite a few differences between Ayurveda and Western medicine. Ayurveda is seen to be a preventative, and in Western medicine, it's usually once you have the condition when you start treating it. Whereas in Ayurveda, it teaches us how we can recognize things in our body, indications in our body that are showing us that something isn't quite right before it gets to a critical stage. Now, because Ayurvedic treatment is natural, often the things which are better for us end up taking a longer amount of time. And so because Ayurveda tries to get to the root cause of the issue, it often can take a little bit longer than Western medicine. Another big difference is that in Ayurveda, everybody is seen as a unique person, not one medicine to fit all. It's really about the individual. And so treatment, whether it's to do with the food that you're eating, the medication that you need, the herbs that you need, the environment that you need, even if we both have a cold, you will be treated differently to the way I will, depending on our body type. I personally feel that both approaches are so useful. Using the diagnostic tools and the advanced techniques that we now have in Western medicine with some of the ancient tools and wisdom and healing methods of Ayurveda can become a perfect balance in healing. Ayurveda sees the five elements, earth, water, fire, air, and ether, as the fundamental building blocks of everything around us, humans, nature, the environment, the entire universe. And so let's get to know them a little bit more. Earth is seen as the solid structure in our body, whether it's our muscle, our bones, our nails, our teeth, our hair, all the structural parts of our body come from earth. And remember, the elements are not just in our body, they're in our mind too. And so they're represented or manifest in our mind as the power to withstand. Earth is the power to endure and withstand everything around us. Water is the fluidity in our body, whether it's blood, mucus, tears. Every single thing in our body that is fluid is coming from the water element. And in the same way with our mind, it's all of our thoughts, our emotions. Oh, that's it, thoughts and emotions. Fire is heat and transformation in our body. It's the blood that's going around our body. It's our digestion and our vision. And in the mind, fire is passion and anger, but it's also being able to focus, and it's also our intelligence too. Air is all the movement in our body, whether it's subtle or gross, whether it's our respiratory system or our joint movement. And when it comes to the mind, well, air is the movement in our mind, which often leads to anxiety and stress. Ether manifests in our body as all the space in between our organs, all the space in between our thoughts. And when it comes to the mind, it is actually represented as silence, when we have a silent mind, and therefore ether is really, really prominent during our meditation moments. Now, I feel every time that I talk about Ayurveda, the first thing most people ask me is, what's my dosha? Well, let's discuss that now. The doshas are simply the five elements categorized into three. Just as we all have genes in our body, but our genetic makeup is different, in the same way, in Ayurveda, we have all five elements in our body, but the proportions differ. And so this specific elemental composition is referred to as your dosha. And dosha, actually, when translated, means fault or defect, not constitution. And you might say, that sounds a little bit negative, but actually, the reason it's called dosha is because whenever these elements go out of balance, it is seen to be a fault in our body. That is actually what leads to disease or different conditions in our body. And so there are two key aspects of doshas. We have prakriti and vikriti. Now, prakriti is our original constitution. It is the constitution that we are born with that actually happens from the moment of conception. It's our optimal elemental balance. It's basically our blueprint for perfect health. Now, your constitution ends up affecting everything from your likes and your dislikes, your tendencies, your mental and emotional characteristics, your habits, and your vulnerabilities towards disease and different conditions too. Your prakriti never changes. It stays exactly the same throughout your life. but it can go out of balance. And that leads us to our vikriti, which is our current state of imbalance. It refers to our elemental state right now, and that is affected by everything around us, every single thing that comes into our senses, from our environment, the temperature that we're living in, our lifestyle choices, our eating habits, what foods we are choosing to put into our body. Every single thing that we allow through our five senses can affect our elemental balance and our vikriti. So once we are aware of both our original constitution, our prakriti, and our current state of imbalance, our vikriti, the goal is to adjust our lifestyle, our dietary choices, and our daily habits to try and bridge the gap and bring us back to our original. So let's get into our three magical doshas. We have our vata, our pitta, and our kapha. Now, some people like to refer to it as kapha, depending on the dialect that they're using, but for today, I'm going to be using kapha. So each dosha is a combination of two of the elements. Vata is air and ether, pitta is fire and water, and kapha is earth and water. So each of us do have all three of these doshas in our body because we have all five elements in our body and the doshas are made up of these elements. Most of us have one predominant dosha or sometimes two. Very rarely there will be someone with all three in equal parts. And if that's you, I would keep it to yourself because they may want to experiment on you. Now, sometimes the elements and the doshas can be a little bit difficult to relate to on a daily basis. And so we can break it down a level further to the 20 qualities that are associated with all of these elements. They describe the way that we can experience each element on a day-to-day basis. And so we're able to relate to nature, our surroundings, and actually everything around us using just these 20 qualities. Now, these 20 qualities are actually 10 opposing qualities, like hot and cold, subtle or gross, dry or wet. We can use these qualities to help determine what might be out of balance in our body and what opposite quality we might need in our environment or our food to rebalance. Too much or too little of each quality can lead to disease or conditions in our body. One thing I would like to emphasize is that like increases like and opposites balance each other. And that's really important to remember when we are trying to balance out our body. All ingredients, foods, our environment have a combination of these qualities. And when it comes to food, it actually goes beyond the physical effect of the qualities. For example, when we think about hot and cold. When you're having a salad, for example, and you may have black pepper or ginger in the dressing, the salad is cold, it's just come out of the fridge. When you eat it, it feels cold in your mouth. But as you digest it, or even as it hits your throat, you'll feel the warmth of the black pepper or the ginger. And so, just because something is cold as you're eating it, doesn't mean when it's digested that it has a cooling effect on your body. And in the same way, if you were having warm milk at night, but you decided to add in fennel seeds. Fennel seeds are a cooling spice. Now, it may have been heated in the milk, but actually when it comes into your body, it has a cooling effect. The post-digestive effect is cooling to your body. And so what's really wonderful and what I would really recommend that you try is starting a food diary. Writing down everything you're eating, all the ingredients that you're having, and noticing what effect is it having according to these qualities. Does it feel drying to the body? Does it feel like it adds moisture to the body? How do my joints feel? How does my hair feel? How does my skin feel? And relate it back to these 10 opposing qualities to really get yourself familiar with how we can use these to rebalance ourselves. Now, there are different qualities categorized into the three different doshas. So let's start with vata. If you think about what vata is a combination of, it's a combination of air and ether. Now remember, air was movement and ether was space. So which qualities out of these 20 do you think would relate to both of those elements? We have dry, light, rough, subtle, mobile, and clear. Those are the qualities that relate to vata. Fire is transformation and water was fluidity. And so the qualities related to pitta are hot, sharp, light, moist and oily. And kapha was a mix of earth and water. And remember, earth was stability and water again is fluidity in the body. And so the qualities related to kapha are heavy, slow, smooth, cool, and soft. So when it comes to finding out your dosha, I'm going to go through some of the characteristics to look out for, but I suggest you take an in-depth quiz. And my favorite one I've linked in the caption below. So go and check that out, and it will go into detail about every single part of your life and your body to really determine what your dosha is. But I'd love to go over some of the features now to really get you thinking. Now, when it comes to your dosha, like I said, it takes into account everything from the shape of your eyes, to the length of your fingers, to your body shape, to your bowel habits, your mindset, and all your physical features too. And so eventually, when you start to understand doshas a little bit better, you can actually identify what someone's dosha is just by looking at them, just by looking into their personality a little bit more. And I personally feel it's really helped me understand my friends better, understand my partner better, and been able to decide what kind of foods to cook for them too. So let's start with Vata's physical features. And I just want to say that this is a generic overview because every single thing is on a spectrum. So I'm going to give you the general overview. But remember, everybody is different and Ayurveda celebrates that. And also what I would like to say is that not one is better than the other. Vata, Pitta and Kapha are all equal in terms of their benefits and their downfalls. And so when we're going through these, please keep that in mind. It's not better to be a Vata, it's not better to be a Pitta, it's not better to be a Kapha, it's just better to be who you are. So let's start with Vata and the physical features. So like we said, I'm going to keep repeating this because I want you to learn it. Vata is air and ether. So if you think about the qualities of air and ether, they're light. And the frame of somebody who is a Vata body is very similar. If you have someone in your life that finds it difficult to put on weight, that is very slim, petite, also long features and often long limbs too. Everything is quite petite and small. They have smaller eyes, a smaller nose, very delicate lips. Their hair can be dry and maybe on the thin side. Their skin can also be drier and maybe thinner too. And overall, they just have more of a thin or fragile physique. Now next up, let's talk Pitta. Pitta, remember, is fire and water. And so they have very sharp, angular features coming from the fiery part. They have very prominent eyes, whether it's in color or whether it's in shape. They tend to be medium in body physique. They have medium bone structure, medium-sized hands, medium-sized feet, medium-sized nose, medium-sized lips. Their complexion is often quite rosy because of the fire and the heat in their body. And Kapha, which is earth and water. Now, these are those stable, solid bodies. They have a very, very strong body structure. Often it can be a wider structure, but that's not to say that that person will have a heavier weight than somebody who is a Pitta or a Vata. It's more about the bone structure. It's about the physique. And so they may have a wider structure. It's more sturdy. They're able to endure a lot more physically too. And they have rounder features, maybe a wider face, a wider nose, wider lips, bigger eyes. Everything's a little bit thicker or a little bit shorter when it comes to Kaphas. Their hair can be thick and oily, and their skin is thick and moist because of the water element in Kapha. And so remember, these doshas also affect our mind. So with a Pitta mind, for example, which is fiery, when in balance, you can be sharp, attentive, focused, get things done. But when imbalanced, that can lead to agitation, irritation, aggression if something is not done in the way you want it to be. And that focus, which initially was a positive thing, if out of balance, can turn into a one-track mind and a little bit of stubbornness to not want to move from what you want. I go between Kapha and Vata mind. I would say I'm rarely in the Pitta mind. And so a Vata, if you think about the quality of air, that is a bit scatty, forgets things a little bit easily, doesn't tend to finish one thing at a time because their mind is jumping from one thing to another. That is probably a Vata out of balance. But when in balance, movement leads to creativity in the mind. So it allows you to be creative in so many different ways. It allows you to feel free in movement, to feel free when things are changing around you. And for a Kapha mind, well, if you think about what earth and water do when they mix together, it creates mud. And so when a Kapha is in balance, they can be that friend that you can rely on. They're sturdy, that earth quality allows them to endure lots of things around them without getting too phased. It's that person that you know you can go to for a big cuddle and you know is reliable and always there for you. They're comforting. And when a Kapha is out of balance, well, you can imagine what muddiness does to our mind. It makes us feel stagnant. Kaphas tend to be afraid of change, and so change makes them feel uncomfortable. They like to be set in their own way. They're stuck in the mud. Literally, that's what their mind feels like. And also, kaphas have a tendency towards depression because of the cloudiness and the dull mind that can come from having kapha too high in your mind. And so there are so many other things that the quiz will go into to determine what your dosha is. For example, how fast you talk. And as you can tell, sometimes I talk like a vata because I talk very, very fast. Or how you make decisions, whether you're quick at making decisions, whether you find it difficult to make decisions, or whether you don't like making decisions at all. And it will also go through your bowel movements and everything in between. Everything you could possibly think of to do with your personality, your body, or your mind is included in the quiz. And after that, come back because I'm going to be sharing so much more in-depth information about each of the doshas. Once you know what you are, we can really hone in on the types of food you're going to be needing, on the spices you need in your life, and the environment that's gonna be best for you. So I really hope that this was useful for you all in your journey to Ayurveda. I am so excited for you to start this journey, and I'm so glad that you're doing it with me. I also have an Ayurvedic video on the top 10 tips that my Ayurvedic teacher taught me about how you eat rather than what you eat that's important. So please go and check that out, and I really do believe that those 10 principles can make all the difference in how your gut feels, how your mind feels, and how your body feels too. Sending you all so much love and gratitude for the rest of your week. And that's it.
If you like this video, or even if you didn't like it at all, leave a message anyway so I can get to know you as you get to know me, and we can build a lovely, bouncy family together.